Hello and welcome to What in the World, a show where geo-Googlers help you get the most out of your enterprise maps products with tips and advice. My name is Dylan Thomas. I'm a community manager on the Maps team, and joining me today is Dave McCluskey. Dave is a solutions engineer helping enterprise customers architect and validate their solutions. Hi, Dave.
Hi, Dylan.
And so Dave today is going to be talking specifically about the Places API, which is a set of APIs that are part of the Enterprise Maps solution set product suite. So Dave, take it away. Let's see what we've got today.
Sure. Thanks. So yeah, as Dylan mentioned, today I'm going to talk to you about the Places API, which is a very powerful API that allows you to integrate Google's database of over 100 million points of interest into your web or mobile application. If you're not familiar with the Places API, it provides a search capability to look for local points of interest like restaurants or other sorts of landmarks, bring them into your application. You can do a variety of searches based off keywords or text queries, and you can bring in some detailed information about these points of interest like reviews, opening hours, costs, business photos. And including Zagat reviews. So since we acquired Zagat back in 2011, we've been working to incorporate those premium editorial reviews into the Places API service and allow you to leverage those reviews in your application. Another really cool feature about the Places API is the autocomplete service. So this provides that type-ahead address autocomplete functionality that a lot of users have come to expect from a Google Maps service, being able to type in an address and select from a drop-down list suggested addresses. So I'll give you a quick demo just to show you here what I'm talking about. Okay, so this demonstration uses the Places API to bring in some local content into a web application. So what you see here at the top is the use of the Google Maps API to show a Google map as well as a Street View image here on the right. At the top of a Google map, there's a search box, and this is using that autocomplete API. So you can use this autocomplete API not only to autocomplete an address query, but also categories or restaurant names. So in this example, I'm searching for restaurants. And I brought those results of the restaurant search here onto my map. I'm displaying it as markers on the map, and if you look below, I'm also displaying the text-based results. So all this information that you're seeing here is coming straight out of the Places API. On the left, I'm showing the Zagat score, and in the center here, I'm showing the Zagat editorial review, and on the right, I'm showing a business photo that's coming from the Places API service. There's a lot more information that's available in the Places API that I'm not showing. You can bring in price, for example. Is this an expensive restaurant, an inexpensive restaurant? You can bring in information like operating hours. Are they open now or not? You can also bring in Google Plus reviews as well. So in addition to the Zagat reviews, there's those Google Plus reviews as well that you can incorporate.
So this is obviously pretty good for entertainment and hospitality industry. It looks like you sort of focus this on restaurants in your autocomplete as well. Is that something, I think that's something you can control, right? Whether you're going to focus the autocomplete results on addresses or a certain kind of place.
Yeah, and it turns out in our Places API database, like I mentioned, there's over 100 million places. We have something like 60 different categories you can choose from. So I'm showing restaurants, but you could search airports, banks, ATMs. There's tons of different categories, you know, hospitals. It goes on and on, really. So it's quite a bit of information. And it is great, as you mentioned, hospitality sites, travel sites, hotel sites, any sort of site that wants to enable a location-aware content, this is very, very valuable, especially for mobile applications as well.
Okay, and then one other thing I wanted to ask there is, can you make it sort of really obvious which parts of what you're showing here are actually the Maps API, the JavaScript library there, and which parts the Places API is adding to the mix?
Sure. So here at the top, I'm showing a Google Map here on the left and a Street View image on the right. That's all coming from the Google Maps JavaScript API. And it's pretty cool being able to tie these two services together. But all of this location information that I'm showing, this point of interest information about the restaurants, these addresses of the restaurants, that's all coming from the Places service. And in this case, I'm using the Places API web service. There's a JavaScript version and a web service version, and I'll get into that in a little bit more detail about when you want to use which.
Got it. Thanks.
So, as I just mentioned, there is a JavaScript version as well as a web service version of the Places API. I say typically you want to use the JavaScript version if you can. It's very easy to use. It's well integrated with the Google Maps API. When you want to use the web service version is typically when you need to call it from a server, when you don't have a client application, for example. If you need to make a lot of bulk or batch requests, the web services are preferred. One thing to note, however, is those Zagat reviews are only currently available in the web service. So if you want to incorporate those premium editorial reviews, you do need to be using the web service to get that information.
And I think what you're showing here also is one of the big topics that comes up with our customers as they move from the sort of the free version of the API with its capabilities to the enterprise or the business version of the API is real quota consideration and what changes there.
Right. So when you're using the free version of the API, you start off with 1,000 free queries a day. If you verify your identity and put in a credit card, that gets upped to 100,000 queries a day. But you don't get the Zagat reviews. That's only in the enterprise license, and you don't get support or a service level agreement. You need your enterprise license for that. And of course, with the enterprise license, that can be sized for whatever query amount of quota that you need, the number of queries that you need per day. We can size you for that.
Got it. So it's sort of the queries per second, then it's also the maximum, the total daily quota are the two things that you're looking at when you're validating this enterprise solution versus a free version, right?
Exactly. And I can explain a little bit more about how we count quota for the
purchase. Oh, perfect. Great.
So essentially, every sort of request to the Places API counts as a query, as a request against that 100,000 per day quota limit that you have or whatever you negotiate as part of your business license. There are a few exceptions. So, for example, if you're doing a normal search that counts as a request, but we also have something called a radar search and a text search. These are a little bit different types of searches you can do. A radar search brings in a lot more results, and a text search allows you to perform more of a Google natural language type of query, like pizza in New York, a string type of query. And those count as 5 or 10 queries each, so it's a little bit more than a standard search. The other sorts of operations count as one query each, so such as bringing in a Zagat review, that's an extra request, or bringing in a business photo, for example, that's an extra request. So you need to start looking at your implementation to really assess how many queries you're going to be using. So it does vary heavily by your implementation. And you can design your application to use a lot or to use a little. The autocomplete API is something else we get asked a lot about as well. And that also counts as a query every time you call that autocomplete API service.
Got it. And I notice that you've got some things in red. These are clearly differences between the web service and the JavaScript API. So that's if you're doing some sort of CRUD action, if you're working with Places to add and remove them, which is a capability of the API, it looks like that is something you only want to be doing or can do through the web service.
Yeah, that's true. So for the most part, the functionality is duplicated across both services. There are a few differences. So some of the actions, these are called actions to add a place, delete a place. Those are only available through the web service version, as well as the Zagat reviews. Those are only available through the web service version.
One other thing I was just thinking of here is that we showed an example using the Maps API and the Street View API, but you can also use the Places autocomplete independent of a map entirely, right? You can just use that to get really good address input to your application.
That's right. So you can use the whole Places API without a Google Map. We don't require that you show the results on a Google Map.
Got it. I think we have some idea about what you can do with that, which other kind of map you might want to put that on downstream. But yeah, you don't have to have a map while you're finding the address, I think.
So you can't put places data on a non-Google map, but it doesn't have to be on a map.
Because that would just not be cool.
So maybe I can walk you through an example because that does that quota does get a little complicated sometimes. I can show you that example of the demo I just showed and show you how many counts or queries against that quota that would take up.
Excellent.
So in the example that I showed, typing in a so taking a look at the screenshot here, I'm starting to type in a query. So for the word restaurant, say I type in the first four letters, REST. And if I call the autocomplete API each time, that would be four queries right there. When I perform a text search, that could be 10 queries. And then say if I show six results, and for each one of those results, I show a SIGAT review. And for each one of those results, I show a business photo, that would be six more requests each. So just showing this page that for the screenshot here that I'm showing would be about 26 requests to the Places API.
Oh, this is really helpful. So presumably this is the kind of thing that you talk with customers about when they're going through an implementation, is sort of just take a really close look at how they're using it and what the impact is on their quota and also their performance on the page.
That's right, because how you design this application is going to affect how many requests you're making. For example, if you wanted to have the user click before you show a SIGAT review, you could optimize the number of queries you make by waiting for that user action before you make the request, as opposed to showing them all automatically like I am here.
Oh, that's a good watch point, actually. I didn't think of that one. That's a really good tip. That's why we're talking to you. So let me just ask you one other question then. It seems like that sort of the enterprise angle of this is quite heavily geared towards the management of quota and keeping a watch on things. Do you have any suggestions about how people can plan for the initial launch of their site or track for things that you've seen, like the quota being blown out just due to a very successful website launch, for example? What are the kinds of things you tell customers they should do to get ready for that kind of thing?
Sure. So, I mean, the most important thing you can do is upfront planning, is understanding how we count quota and planning your application accordingly to make efficient use of your quota. The next thing is we offer a variety of usage reports. So, within the API console, you can track your usage against these services to see how much usage you're getting and track that over time. And then, as you're approaching, running out of quota, we do send emails, alerting you at various points that you're reaching the end of quota.
Got it. So you can sort of do the proactive thing yourself, but then if you start getting emails from Google letting you know you're getting close, then you probably want to take a close look at that and potentially get in touch with Google, right?
Right, and definitely monitoring those usage reports over time to make sure there are no surprises is really key.
Cool. Great. Good tips. Thanks very much. So, Dave, I think we're pretty much at time now. I want to thank you for your insights and going over the product. Really helpful.
Thanks, Dylan.
And we'll see you next time on What in the World.